This is Wolfgang Hoppe of East Germany. He's already won the two-man race. He was the leader after two heats in the four-man. But you have to wonder if he was unnerved yesterday by this track here, Trbevich. He said it took a lot of skill to negotiate the dangerous course. He was concerned. The track is worse today, and Hoppe is not that experienced. 26 years old. His number two man is Roland Wetzig, a 6'1", 190-pounder, discus champion. Dietmar Schauerhammer is in the third spot. He, too, is a track man, big guy from Jena. And the brake man is Andreas Kirschner, 6'3", 220 pounds, former shot putter. Look at that sled, John. It's gorgeous.
I tell you, there's two different features of that sled that nobody else has. One, they have shock absorbers on the runners. You can see that. Okay? And the second thing is, look at the split in the cowling there. There's two splits. One going down and the one on top. There's a cowling within a cowling. The articulation in bobsledding gives the sled the ability to walk on and off the corners. You know, you remember the Soviet sled, there was no articulation. It was a plank sled. Their articulations are for the front runners. So these Germans here have a double advantage. One, the shock absorbers. Two, the two splits in the cowling.
In the summertime, Wolfgang Hoppe races around the countryside on a dirt bike, so he's used to rough tracks. The best time, 6:30, his 6:31.
Just like yesterday. Again, these Germans are consistent, and that's bobsledding. We're consistent. Bobsledding are synonymous.
Question is, with the lead, can he attack the course and go after it with reckless abandon?
I don't think he has to attack the course. That sled's fast, and you've got a great start time. He's just going down, and he's doing his flow right here.
Just try to keep the line.
Perfect there. Here he comes into seven. Here comes the split time. On the left, the Soviets. 32:47. 30 hundredths better than the Soviets. Good low line through Omega.
200-degree turn. Being hit by force four times out of gravity as he heads into the labyrinth. Very low line.
Exactly where he wants to be. Hoppe is hot here.
Tremendously fast run. Hoppe comes in. Final curve. Through and down with a time. 50:18. Puts him in first place. Best time of the day.
Unbelievable consistency. That's the same exact time as he had his second heat yesterday.
Wolfgang Hoppe, East Germany number one, assaulting the leaderboard and going after his second gold. Hoppe has been able to negotiate some of the trickier parts of this course better than all of the other drivers. John takes a look at one of the critical turns on this track.
Every bobsled course has its pivotal parts. Here at Trbevich is Curve 9. Curve 9 allows you to attack the labyrinth if you come out of it properly. If you don't, you don't have the chance to attack the labyrinth and you'll eventually lose time. For example, this is the medium low line being used by the East German and Swiss sleds. Up here is an improper line. It's a high line. It forces the drivers to come down off the corners. They end up hitting the right-hand wall and then going into Curve 10, the first of the three labyrinths, and negotiate all sorts of problems. So the right line through Curve 9 for the labyrinths, the medium low line here.
Here is a driver that's done extremely well on the critical parts of the course. Bernhard Lehmann, East Germany number two, second place after yesterday's two heats. He is in second place. He knows what he has to do. He knows what lies in front of him. He knows the track is chewed up, and he knows how to attack it. Bernhard Lehmann, silver medalist in the two-man. His number two-man is Bogdan Musial, former sprinter. The number three-man is Ingo Foga, 26 years old, 175 pounds. And the brakeman is Eberhard Weiss, a motor mechanic from Oberhof.
There's that sleek East German sled. You see the cowling. That is a split in the front of cowling. That lets the cowling roll within another cowling. And then the articulation split, which goes down there, that allows the sled to walk on and off the corners.
Totally designed for aerodynamics. They even tape up the rake-like brakes in the back so it doesn't slow them down.
Again, the East Germans are, you got to give them credit. They do everything so right in this sport.
Psycho Cybernetics, looking down the course, picturing what's in front of him, knowing what he has to do to take over the top spot from his countryman, Wolfgang Hoppe.
Well, I think there's a little competition here between these two because Hoppe is 26, Lehmann 36. Hoppe's a second generation East German bobsledder. I think Lehmann, this probably be his last Olympics. He'd probably like to see himself get a gold medal here.
Like a sprinter out of the blocks. Now they have to get in the sled. 6:32, extremely competitive. 200s off the pace set by Ekmanis of the Soviet Union.
This is where the East Germans are precise up top. They don't touch anything up here. On and off the corners, exactly where they want to be. Now 5, 6, and 7, we say this so much, they're lower here than anybody else.
Lehmann says you only drive the sled when you're in trouble. You let it do all the work.
7, look, oh, a little adjustment there, a little problem there. 32:47, that's the cost of 32:51. He's usually faster than Hoppe up top.
Johnny did a loop in Omega.
Same problem he had yesterday. He's got a little more problems down here.
Staying very low through the labyrinth, coming around. He's really flying now. 71 miles an hour as he comes around the final curve. His time, 50:32, puts him in second place.
Not as good a heat as Hoppe. He had some problems up there in Omega. He had a time second. He leading yesterday at 50-33. That's consistency.
Bernhard Lehmann, East Germany's number two driver, now in second place. But the story is still Wolfgang Hoppe, the East German who wasn't even sent to the European Championships on this course last winter. He continues his assault on the Sarajevo goal. So it's East Germany number one, East Germany number two, and the Swiss, Silvio Giobellina in third.